Our second reading comes from 1 Timothy chapter 2. The last parts of that reading is what Pastor will be talking to us about and sharing with us. First of all, then I urge that supplication, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good and is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. For this I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I'm not lying. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarreling. Likewise also that women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel, with modesty and self-control, not with braided hair and gold or pearls or costly attire, but with what is proper for women who profess godliness with good works. Let a woman learn quietly with all submissiveness. I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man. Rather, she is to remain quiet. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. That she will be saved through childbearing, if they continue in faith and love and holiness with self-control. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
God. Please. All creation moves in a cosmic dance before the Lord, her King. In the rhythms, the reasons, the rhyme of the dance, it pulses within everything. In the universe, wheels and whirls like a dervish in perfect seven-step time. The Lord made a dance and he taught her steps, draws his sunshine. But dance, 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 dance in God's honor. It is praise. Jesus danced into the world, singing his heavenly song. He taught the dance to those who listen and learn as he moved along. By the steps of his dance that led him to a cross, where he died while the haters mocked on. And he danced through death's arms and over hell's gates, and 3 days danced forth from his tomb.
Our sermon tonight, today, whatever time of day it is, from 1 Timothy 2, 11 through 15, as Pastor Hensler read. It's a difficult passage. It is. Let a woman learn quietly in all submissiveness. I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man. Rather, she is to remain quiet. For Adam was formed first and then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Yet she will be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith and love and holiness with self-control. Now, I got through that. I noticed, thankfully, that none of you threw anything at me. I asked the elders to check, especially the women coming in, your purses, to make sure there was no rotten fruit in there or no rotten vegetables. It's a hard passage. It is. There's a lot of pastors within and without the LCMS that won't touch this reading. There are some LCMS churches that will read 2 Timothy and they'll read up to, or 1 Timothy chapter 2, they'll read up to verse 7 and they'll stop to avoid this part. I can tell you our big Lutheran brother, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, ELCA, they don't read it. They have the same appointed lesson for them. They stop at verse 7. And that makes sense because they have women pastors, and it would be darn hard for a woman pastor to read this in worship and preach it on it, would it not? Yet here it is. And believe me, as I was telling Pastor Hensler earlier, I wanted to avoid this passage. I wanted to put 1 through 7 and leave it go at that. But the Lord wouldn't let me. And here's the reason. Something that Paul writes in 2 Timothy chapter 3. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. That the man of God and the women of God may be competent and equipped for every good work. 11 through 15 is there in Scripture. Paul wrote it. It's there for our edification. It's there for our building of faith. It's there for drawing us closer to Jesus. If I cut it out, what am I saying about my faith in Scripture? And I find the hard passages, as Pastor Hensler said, throughout Pentecost here, there's been some hard passages. But in those hard passages is where we find the fruit of repentance that changes our hearts and minds. And perhaps as we read that section of Scripture, it's not really what we think it is. Perhaps if we dive in a little bit deeper, we can see. When I was in seminary, there was a joke going around, a tall tale, and it was about a pastor who did preach on these verses. He got up and he's in the pulpit, and all of a sudden, as I said, women pulled out rotten fruit and tomatoes and started whipping it at him. They hit him and he fell down on the ground, knocked him out. They drug him out of the sanctuary, tied him to a car, drug him down the road, and when they finally let him loose, he took off and he was never, ever seen again. Now, I'm praying that's a wives' tale. But just to make sure, I did go to my elders and say, hey, will you have my back? Pastor Hensel, you have my back. Look where he's sitting. That's a joke. This is a difficult passage. And the truth is, on my own, I'm not equipped to handle it. But all Scripture is breathed out by the Holy Spirit, and He is here. So let's pause for a moment. Join me as we pray and ask for His help as we look at this. Lord God, may what I teach and preach this morning, may what these children of yours who are gathered here to hear your word, what they hear, what crosses their ears and their minds, may the meditations of their heart be always good and acceptable in your sight. For you alone are our rock, our redeemer, our God. In your Son's name I ask this. Amen. So I found three important points in understanding these verses, and I'm going to try to go through with you, as quickly as possible. The first one, it's always important with a difficult passage to look at the context. And what is the context of this passage? We find this in the first couple of verses of our reading, 1 Timothy 2, 1 to 4. First of all, I urge that supplication, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet and godly and dignified life in every way. This is good and it's pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So we have prayer. We can pray everywhere, but where do we come and pray as a group? Here. Prayer is worship. Worship is the place where all people can be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth because the gospel is being proclaimed. It's where Jesus Christ is proclaimed to you. So the setting of all of the instructions, both to men and women, are in worship. Corporate worship. Gathered together as you and I are. And we can see this a little bit later on. Paul writes, I desire then that in every place the man should pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or quarreling. Don't know, this was written to Timothy, who was the pastor in Ephesus. Don't know if men were coming into the church and duking it out. Men do have a tendency to be a little animosity towards others. Paul's saying, concentrate your prayer on God and your love for one another. Use your holy hands to show love to God and one another and not hatred. Likewise also that women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel with modesty and self-control, not with braided hair and gold or pearls or costly attire. Paul is not talking about what you wear to the grocery store. He's talking about what men and women do when they come into worship. And in both cases, are we focusing on our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, or turning attention upon ourselves? But with what is proper for women who profess godliness with good works, both men and women, by what we say and what we do and how we dress, should show our love and faith in Jesus Christ in an outward manner. All of this context is in the public worship setting. And that's important because when we take it outside the public worship setting, we have, well, some of the pitfalls and mistakes that have been made in the past. Such things as those who teach that women should never hold office. We shouldn't have a woman governor. We shouldn't have women rule over us in any way, shape, or form. Paul is not talking about what happens out in the secular world. This passage about women is also used as the reason why, for a long time, women weren't allowed to vote in church, in congregational meetings. Paul's not talking about congregational meetings. He's not talking about women being on the church council. That is the secular side, the governing side of the church. He's talking about the spiritual side. He's talking about the pastoral office. He's telling this young pastor, Timothy, here's how you should operate as a pastor in proclaiming and teaching the word of God. Second important point, we have Paul's reference to Adam and Eve. For Adam was formed first, and then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Adam formed first and Eve, we're talking about creation. So we need to turn our thoughts and minds back to Genesis. Then God said, "Let us make man in our own image after our own likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Male and female, equally created in the image of God. One not better than the other, equally created, both having that wonderful image of God. And God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on earth." God uniquely gave to them the ability to do these things and do it perfectly because, first and foremost, they had the image of God, which means they were holy. It means that they knew God's will more than you and I ever could. They didn't have sin, a selfish heart blocking the way. God equipped each one of them with gifts, gifts to fulfill this. Not equal gifts in every way. Generally, and I know you can find exceptions, but generally speaking, men are stronger, they have more muscles. They can do more physical labor. Not that women can't or shouldn't, men are better equipped to that. And of course, women, you are honored because there's something you can do that I would never be able to do, and that is produce offspring, to give birth to a baby. In both of these things, Adam and Eve were uniquely set and created by God to fulfill his jobs of procreating, being fruitful and multiply, and taking care of the garden, managing it. Managing it not as my own personal possession, but as a wonderful gift from God. For Adam was formed first, and then Eve. And that was true. Adam was formed first. Before Eve was even on the scene yet, Adam received this. "It is not good that a man should be alone. I will make a helper for him." Adam wasn't complete by himself. There's a unique story in there, and I think it's actually kind of funny. Before Eve is introduced, Adam has all the animals come to him, and he gets to name them. This is part of that having dominion. When you got to name something, you kind of were the controller of it, the gracious controller. So up comes a zebra. "Can a zebra help me?" "Nah, don't think so." "Here's a warthog. Can that be my partner?" No, I don't think so." "A skunk? Oh God, please no." Adam names all the animals, but the comment after that is over is none of them were a fit helper for him. None of them could come alongside and work with him to do these two jobs that God had, to procreate and to take care of the garden. So what does God do? Puts Adam to sleep. Takes a rib out of Adam and uses it to form Eve. Now, if Eve and Adam kept separate, Adam is physically without a rib. Adam and Eve needed to come together as husband and wife, as a couple, to be able to fulfill God's plan for mankind, to have dominion and to procreate. Each one brings something different to the table. Each one is very, very important. The man sits there and says to Eve, "No, you don't carry the child, I'll do it." Hey, it ain't going to work, is it? Adam was formed first. And before Eve came along, Adam received this commandment. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Eve is not there. Adam heard this commandment. It was Adam's job to tell Eve this and to make sure they both followed it. In this, what we would say is Adam was given to be the spiritual head of the household. Now, that doesn't mean that Eve was supposed to bring him his slippers and bow down to him and worship him. Eve brought a lot of different things to the table, and in every other way, they were equal. In procreation and having a child, Adam couldn't do that. But as far as the role of being the spiritual head of the household, that was given to Adam. And how did he do with it? He failed. Paul writes, "Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became the transgressor." This is true. But who's standing next to Eve that whole time? Who is? Adam. Eve is there and she's talking to a snake, a serpent. Not a good idea, especially when that serpent is Satan. Adam is standing there. She's having a dialogue with Satan, and at some point Adam should have said, "Come on, honey, let's go. Let's get out of here." But he doesn't. He stands there with his mouth shut. And Eve was deceived. Eve was told, "You know what? Life would be a heck of a lot better if you had this one thing that you don't have. If you knew the difference between good and evil. If you had that knowledge, well, hey, you could be like God." Sounds good, right? Except Eve already was like God. She already had the image of God. She knew good. She didn't know evil. She didn't need to know evil, but as soon as she transgressed, now she knew evil. She ate, and what does she do? She gives it to Adam, and what does he do? He eats. Sure, she listened to the serpent and transgressed, but he didn't do his job first, which was to stop that from happening. And we see once again Adam being the spiritual head of the household when God comes and calls him to task for their sin. Lord God called to who? The man. "Where are you?" And he said, I heard the sound of you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" He's talking to Adam, not Eve. Eve may have eaten first, but Adam is the one that's responsible for this as spiritual head of the household, and he failed. That's what happens when we don't follow God's plan and design. Things don't go well. It's important to remember why Paul brings up Adam and Eve. He's bringing up the fact that God has, in the order of creation, vocations, responsibilities for men and women. Men are to be spiritual heads of the household in the family setting, but that also, as far as we're concerned, this is the spiritual household of God. And he appoints pastors, men, to act out that spiritual role here. How are we doing? Men, how are you doing? I can tell you as a husband and as a father, I failed repeatedly. It's your job to do the prayers. It's your job to make sure the family gets to the church. I wasn't always faithful with that. And even as a pastor, being the spiritual head of this household, I'm a human being and I fail. That's why our third point is important. This comment of being saved through childbearing. Now, I checked with a couple different places, and our ESV translation falls a little bit short in how it reads this verse. I think this, having translated from the Greek, is much, much better. This is from a translation called God's Word to the Nations. It was a Lutheran translation for confirmation students years ago. However, she, Eve, and all women will be saved through the birth of what? The child. Who is the child? Jesus. The one that God sent, as Paul said, to be that mediator for us, because we can't help but transgress his law, his will, his commands, and his design. God sent Jesus. Paul states it beautifully. For there is one God, and there is also one mediator between God and man. The mediator that brings peace between us and God. Because our transgressions can only bring anger and wrath and send us to eternal hell. But Christ came to intercede for us and bring peace. And how did he do that? By giving of himself his own body. He gave himself as a ransom for all, which was a testimony given at the proper time. His body and blood on the cross, shed for you, paying the price for your sins, so you would never, ever, ever have to suffer that in eternal hell. All of our transgressions, Christ removes them from our lives because of the birth of the child. Now, as we continue out in our lives, we do have roles that we're given. Women have roles and men have roles. And how you break that up in your family, that is up to you. I'm not here to say that the man should control the money or the woman should control the money. The man should change the oil in the car or the woman should change the oil in the car. There's nothing that Scripture talks about that. That is up to you and how you work out your life. But here in the church, we're impressed upon two things. Paul lifts up the ideal of childbearing, especially how God became man from a virgin, how he entered the human race to be mediator. And likewise, women should be lifted up and lauded for doing this wondrous miracle, for being a part of God doing what nobody else could do, creating new life and bringing it into the world. And men are given to be the spiritual head of the household. And when we fail, this mediator is the one that makes it right for us. Does the passage sit a little bit better with you now? If I was out in the world and I preached this, I don't think I would get the same reception. The world says that men and women should be equal in all things, and women should be able to do every single thing that a man could do. Men can't give childbirth. Men can't produce a child. Women are given many, many wondrous things to do. Here in the church, to serve, to be part of the council, even to read Scripture, which will be happening on LWML Sunday. But God has said in his majesty and his will, the pastoral office is for a man. Even though you have a broken, sinful man such as me. But the Holy Spirit works through me, I pray. And may he work through you. Whatever your role is in the family, and draw you closer to your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.